Hello, welcome to this video session. So our primary outcome for this video will be to make sure that at the end of this video, students will be able to debug Python code in PyCharm IDE. When we are in a layman's word, debugging is nothing but it's a process in which a developer tries to remove bugs in our code. So during this process, there are a lot of functionalities which are performed by a developer. To have this demo, what I'm going to do is I'm going to have a live hands-on session wherein I'll be showing you how PyCharm's debugging features can be realized. Let us move to our PyCharm IDE, and before we move, let us also see what all are the prerequisites before we move to the hands-on. I expect our audience to be well versed with the fundamentals of Python language and also to have a stable PyCharm IDE, preferably community editions running on their machines, if you are following the video along with me to practice the hands-on. So let us do the hands-on. So I'm going to switch to PyCharm IDE. So let me switch to PyCharm IDE. So now I am on a PyCharm IDE. What I have here, I already have a project. So I have created a project with name factorial, where I'm supposed to write a code to calculate a factorial of a number. So we'll consider one fixed number and we'll try to write a factorial code so that we end up calculating factorial of that number. And we'll also debug the same program through a PyCharm code. So let us write a small Python code snippet which would calculate a factorial of a number. So what we will do is, let us define a small method so which will calculate a factorial. So to this, we'll provide a variable number whose factorial my function gonna return. So let us write a code to calculate the factorial of a number here. So what one here, and is equal to temp var into I, because our I values are iterating from number to zero. And once we are done with this, we can return the value temp var. So this, I think we don't need a semicolons, and even putting semicolons wouldn't make any difference here. So that's our method there. Now we can directly take number from a user. Let us do one thing. We'll take a number from a user. We'll say num is equal to input. We'll put a small dialog here. So then we'll take it, and what we will do is we'll print and we'll directly call the method factorial here. Factorial of number. Okay. So if this is a program, now what we will do is we'll not run the program. Even if this program has some internal bugs within that, we'll try to figure out what exactly are bugs in this program if it has. If not, we'll be at least able to go through the chain of execution where we will be able to explore variables in live. So without executing that, we'll debug that. And we all know that whenever we want to debug, especially all IDEs or any debuggers or for any languages, they come with a concept called as breakpoint. So breakpoint is nothing but a point at which your flow of execution stops for you to review. And upon you step from that breakpoint, you will be executing the instruction at that breakpoint location. So what we'll do is we'll just put a breakpoint where we want our execution to stop so that we can check the value here. So I want to check the value here before I return the variable. So I'm placing my cursor here and I'll click on that. The appearance of red circle indicates that there is a breakpoint over there. And this statement would always execute after loop. But at the same time, I also want to see what are the variables when my loop executes. So I'll put two breakpoints here. And what else I'll do is, I think that's fine. So we'll keep two breakpoints here. Anyhow, we are just printing the numbers here. Okay, so let us execute. So now before we execute, let us save these contents of the script factorial.py. And now instead of clicking on run factorial, what I'll be doing is I'll click on debug factorial, or either you can click debug and select a proper script which you want to execute. So I'll click on debug factorial. Now you can see that the moment I have clicked the number here, it is asking me to enter number because this is the first line to start. So I'll enter a number. Let's say I'll enter 5, and we all know that the 5 factorial is 125, and after entering 5, you can see that my console now directly went into debugging mode. Earlier I had entered input here in the console, but did it print the value of a factorial? No, yet. Why? Because my program paused at this point. So when I pause my program at this point, what I have are the following variables. So let me remove this. This is a redundant watch variable which I had from the earlier session. So these are the variables during the debug sessions. Now you can see that the value of I is 5 because the num5 was entered here, and the range starts from 5. And if I execute this loop, if my this expression is right, you should see the value of I dropping from 5 to 1. 0 is always exclusive. So this minus indicates stepping. And at the same time, I want temp to have the value of multiplication of variables. So let me execute one by one. So now I'm at this breakpoint. So now my what I am supposed to do is I want to move ahead from here. So this process is called stepping. So we basically have multiple step processes. One is called a step over, which lets me directly move to the next breakpoint. And we have other stepping functionalities, which we call them as step into and step out. Step into is used for a breakpoint where we have a function call. And suppose I want to debug the function call and the code within that function, I would always click on step into. And whenever you're debugging the functions, and for a moment, if you find you would no longer want to debug the method, but you want to come out of that method and execute the usual function call as it is, you would click on step out. So step into and step out are used to enter into a method, and from where you want to further debug deep down into method called chain. Right now, I don't want to do that. I just want to step over from breakpoint to breakpoint. An easy shortcut is F8. So now what I'm doing is I'm actually pressing F8 to move to the next breakpoint. So here I'm going to press F8. Yes, I have pressed an F8. You can see that the temp has executed. This line has executed. The breakpoint was here. It got executed. Since I clicked on step over, the breakpoint executed. It went the further subsequent instruction it is supposed to execute, which is the loop iteration. Now you can see that once again it is stuck at that. You can see that I value is 5. And if I execute once again, you can see that I values is just dropping. And you can see that if I further execute this, you should find the temporary variables properly incrementing. So now it is 20. Yes, so my assumption is right here. Temp into I, where I value is gradually dropping from 5 to 1. So I'm just clicking F8, and I'll see if I'll be ever coming out of this loop. Okay, 120. Yes, I'm 1. I'm back. I'm at the return statement because now I have exceeded the for loop iterations. And now when I click on F8, I'll be coming out of this function, and probably you should see the print of the factorial. So before I click on F8, let me check what output I have. I don't have any output on console. So now I'm back to my debugging console, and I'm going to hit F8 for last time. Okay, I'm at this point. So now when I click further, yes, I have completed my debug execution. And when you switch to console, you should see the factorial as 120. So this is how we generally debug a Python script. And what is more important here is to make sure you the choice of breakpoint should be very meticulously done. So properly placed breakpoints will let you debug the code script more effectively than improperly placed breakpoints. I'll show you a small concept called as watch and evaluate expressions. So this was our earlier code. Let me do one thing. Let me debug the code once again. So I'll enter a number. This time I'll enter 3. So after entering that, I'm on a debug console. Now you can click F8 to move, so on to move. But remember, sometimes I have these variables, and sometimes I want to specifically choose a variable and make sure I specifically watch that variable. So that functionality is given to me with the help of a window called as watch variable. So here, So I want to watch tempware. So even this you can do that. So it keeps on showing you the value of this. But generally what I prefer is we can also evaluate expression in ahead. So if you see here, right now the tempware is 1. I can dynamically even modify the temporary variable with the help of evaluate expression. So if I say tempware is equal to tempware plus 10. And if I hit enter, it automatically evaluates that expression, and you can see that the value of tempware is set to 21 because I have evaluated a evaluate expression. So what evaluate expressions give you? They let you dynamically modify the value of a variable. So sometimes you can even modify the value of a variable with the help of watch variable as well. For example, I is equal to 3, I want to set I equal to, let's say I want to set I equal to 5. So I can even do this. If I set I equal to 5, you can also say that when I'm able to enter the watch variable window, through watch variable also I was able to set here. But basically what I'm doing is I'm doing some kind of evaluate expression kind of stuff here. So this watch and evaluate, these are two functionalities which let you deeply observe the value of variable, at the same time also observe some of the changes that variable could result into some other variable with the help of evaluation of expressions as well. So now if I continue further, you will randomly find some different results because I have dynamically set a different variable. So let me process this. You can see that now it is not calculating factorial because I have dynamically changed all the variables. So though we have entered 3, I am getting this because I had modified the values of I and temp in dynamic. So this was watch and evaluate. So what do you think, as a quick reflection in this video, what do you think? Does watch window let you change the value of a variable? You can pause and you can revisit the video and you can answer. But the answer for this question is yes. It lets you change the value of a variable dynamically during execution. So this is a bibliography, and that's it for this video. Thank you.